Mode.
Hi everyone, welcome to today's webinar on emergency response mock drills. My name is James and I'll be your moderator for today's event. And before we get started, I just want to run through some housekeeping items and get you informed on what you can expect from today's webinar. All your lines are muted, so the microphones, while they don't work, you can use the questions box on the right-hand side of your screen to communicate any questions or concerns, and I will respond. Also, you will receive the PowerPoint presentation and the slide deck, the recording, everything will be received tomorrow. Following the presentation, there will be an open question and answer period. You can ask questions by typing them into that chat pane that we discussed a few seconds ago. And so today's presentation is on ER mock drills, how they're planned, should be implemented, reviewed, as you work to educate and prepare your team for a possible EHS emergency, and we'll have our speaker address the agenda in more detail. Today's speaker is Kevin Coulon. He is the Regional Services Director for Field Services in our industrial niche here in the New England region of Triumvirate Environmental. In this role, he manages the wastewater department, routine field service, decontamination, and on-site support. He also manages the emergency response program for all of New England, overseeing programs and responses, along with mock drill programs, which he will discuss today. With that, I'll turn things over to Kevin. Hey, Kevin.
Thanks, James. So in the last couple webinars, we've talked about how to prepare for an emergency and what to do while you're waiting for your response companies to show up. That was in the first one, and the second one was to talk about how to prevent an emergency by doing preventative maintenance measures. So in today's webinar, we're going to be talking a lot more about how to plan and practice the emergency through a tabletop drill and then also doing a mock drill. And the key message for today is that drills are planned, implemented, and reviewed as a training means of educating everyone involved on the appropriate response in the event a true emergency response happens. Training has come up in the past two sessions. This type of training is an interactive training with the other parties that are going to be involved in your emergency response activities. If you were to look at your company before we get into the webinar and ask how frequently do you conduct emergency response mock drills? And James is going to put a poll of questions up. If we can take a few minutes to go through, answer your, how well you think you're prepared and how many times you've actually done a mock drill for emergency response.
And Kevin, that poll is live, so we'll give everybody a few seconds to respond and share the results. All right, so it looks like about 50% do run these mock drills annually, another 22% maybe once, but a long time ago, 13% quarterly, and 11% have never done them.
So for today, there's a pretty wide variety of. Some people are doing it annually, some people do it when you might think of it, and then the ones that are doing it quarterly, you often see the quarterlies are being done in much larger facilities, and we also do run into that people have an emergency action plan or a contingency plan but have never done a mock drill. So today's presentation will hopefully either put those in place for you, maybe it's something that you could adopt into your program, and also see the value that you can get from doing a mock drill. So for the agenda today, we're going to go over who should be involved. We're going to go over identifying the scenario that you want to use, how to complete a tabletop drill, then how to complete a live emergency mock drill, then what you do to review the drill, and then at the end we'll open it up for questions. So the first part of today is who should be involved. And this starts with looking at your emergency action plan or your contingency plan. You want to look at who you identify in there. If you identify the fire department, or if you identify the police department, or a local hospital or an emergency response provider. These are going to be the people that you want to look at to see who's involved. Along with those outside vendors that could come in to help out, you want to also identify your internal ER coordinators. This can sometimes be one person. If you're a smaller facility and you run EH&S, you also run facilities, you're also the ER coordinator, you want to make sure you at least have one backup. So that backup should be in these mock drills. When it comes to the fire department, when you ask them to come in, you should find out who is their hazmat lead or who would respond to a type of hazmat spill or an oil spill at your facility. For the police department, if they're attending, you'd want to ask what level of response are they going to have and who would be leading that, because that's the person you want involved in the tabletop and the mock drill. And then for your response provider, you'd want to have at least one of their response coordinators, an incident commander, or their emergency response manager involved in doing the tabletop and doing the actual drill. And the other one that's out there that we didn't put on here because sometimes people are they're a little cautious when they invite them into their facility, but that's your local DEP. So your local environmental protection agency, if it's a state level or a federal level, it's not always the fact that somebody wants to invite them into their facility, but in the event you were, you would want to know who would show up to help with that tabletop. So now that we've talked about who would be involved, you then want to identify the scenario. You know, what are you going to be practicing on? And how you identify that is, what do you want to test? Do you want to test your worst case spill, your best case spill, or somewhere in between? Are you going to do a spill that is internal within the facility, so there's really not a true effect to the environment? Or is it going to be outside and it's a spill to the environment? You also want to identify what type of release you have on hand, and then was any public involved? Is it external and there's, you know, pedestrians walking by, or is it internal and the public are your coworkers? So use these steps to come up with what you want to train on, what you want to practice on, what you think you may have a gap in, and how you can fill that gap to make sure if you had a spill, you'd be extremely well prepared. And it would go from a worst-case scenario to a best-case scenario. So for today's mock drill, the tabletop and the going through a mock drill, we're going to put out the scenario of, in most niches across all main niches, everybody has delivery trucks that come into their facility. And in most cases, almost all industries are going to have some type of oil tank. So we're going to deal with a delivery truck is backed into an oil tank, resulting in 55 gallons spilling to the environment. Now, when you go through the tabletop, you want to send the scenario with the invite. This will allow a better prepared group and a more effective outcome from both the tabletop and the mock drill. Now that you've sent everything out, we want to complete a tabletop drill. So how we complete a tabletop drill is it starts with the scenario and the steps taken by you in response to the spill. The questions you need to ask yourself is, who will be the main contact? Is that going to be you? Is it going to be someone, one of your coordinators? Do you have an internal emergency response team? Are one of them going to be the main contact during that spill? You also want to identify who would be taking attendance in this tabletop drill. So if you can have someone come in or you create a sign-in sheet, you want to pass it around to everybody so you know who will be there and who's going to be your main contact in the event this was to happen, and also for follow-up after the drill. And then also, in the event it was to come in contact with public or pedestrians, who will redirect the public from walking in the area within your company? So these first three questions are more on the lines of before any responders show up. After you've identified your steps, you want to gain estimated response time for each party and what they will cover. From each party, you want to know who their main contact will be. From each group, it could be a list of multiple people. If it's the fire department, if they have four fire marshals, you may get the list of all four fire marshals, depending on who's on call at that time. If it's your response company, if they have multiple response teams, you may be given four different incident commanders or four different response coordinators. These are going to be the people that you'll be in touch with in the event an actual spill happens. Does that mean that all four from each group are going to be there? Not necessarily. But if they can swing it to get all four in there, you may need a much larger room. What will their roles be when they show up? Will they become the IC, the incident commander, as soon as they show up? Will they come to the scene and you'll be the incident commander in the spill and they're going to be working for you but also following their own incident commander structure? Or are they going to come in and fully take over the team, the full scene? The fire department's going to report into them, the police department, you'll report back, or you just hand the whole scene over to the response company. And then what level of response will each group conduct? Will the fire department come in and just clear the area and then wait until a hazmat response team shows up? Will the police department, what will they do when they show up? Will they just block off the area and make sure no one walks through the spill? And then what the response company will do to clean up the area? Also, on your side, what will you do in the time from when you make the phone call and you find the release to when all these parties show up? Will you be putting down any speedy dry, or will you be putting down any preventative measures? And once you've gone through these, you're then going to ask them if they have any initial questions before starting the tabletop. Prior to coming into the tabletop, you want to make sure that they all have a copy of your emergency action plan or your contingency plan. And make sure that they've read through it, they're familiar with it, so they can come in with any specific questions to the plan prior to starting your tabletop drill. Now, even though you've sent out your emergency action plan, your contingency plan, it's a good idea to have it at the meeting as a reference. In the event that someone hasn't read it or they read it 3 months ago and they want to just review something, you also have it in front of you in case there is a question on it, and you can reference that specific part of your emergency action plan or contingency plan. While completing the tabletop, make sure you do have a note taker. This note taker is going to write down all the questions from the responders. It's also going to write, they'll also write down any questions you have to the responders and write down any of the comments throughout the response. You also want to take notes of any conversations through this tabletop exercise, because you're going to be talking through what will this response company do when they show up, what will the fire department do when they show up, what will the police department, and you're going to be going through steps of the tabletop. So you'd have step one of you made the call, step two, fire department shows up, step three, response company shows up. The fourth one is now you have your police department and the type of cleanup starts, when the fire department will leave, when the police department will leave, when the response company will leave, and who will sign off on that the spill has been completely contained and cleaned up. And also be detailed in your own responses for the tabletop. Be detailed into, will you cover the storm drains? Who will do it? Are you going to do that? Are your people trained to do it? Or are you going to require that your response company or your fire department shows up with covers to cover all the nearby storm drains? Will you be blocking off the area? Or are you going to require that the police department comes in and does it? Or do you have your own internal police department or security that'll be involved to block off the area? And then any other type of preventative measures that will be taken. Do you have the training to put down the speedy dry and do the preventative measures, or put down pig socks in front of catch basins, or put down covers to storm drains and catch basins? Or would you even start the cleanup? Do you have the training to the OSHA level to actually do the cleanup And then once the response company comes in, they would take over. So as detailed as you can be up front is going to help guide the response companies as to what they're going to be doing, from the fire department, police department, to your emergency response provider, and if you even invite them, the Department of Environmental Protection, if you do invite them in. So as you go through the entire tabletop, you run through from start to finish on paper with the group. You compile all the notes and answers to all the questions. You put down notes to each individual step of the response. And from that, you'll take about a, may take you about a week, maybe 2 weeks, to compile it all together, answer all the questions that were asked to you, make any minor updates to your emergency action plan or contingency plan. And then once all that's compiled, you send a recap out to all the attendees. You want to make sure that you also put in the questions and answers. So put their questions in there with your specific answers. And then also put their question, or put your own questions to them with the answers that they gave you. You're also going to update the internal programs, which you just talked about, your emergency action plan or contingency plan. You may also be updating what you have for general spill equipment. So if you walk through the area and what we're talking about on paper is a truck backed into an oil tank that released 55 gallons, well, maybe somebody suggested that you put a storm drain cover on one of the walls in that loading dock. If it wasn't there previously, you can identify in the recap that you've installed preventative measures. So in the event this happens again, someone will grab that and cover the storm drain. And the last part of the post-tabletop is to plan for a live emergency drill. This will be actually rolling out everything that you talked about in the tabletop. This will be putting it into action, and it'll be testing what everybody has said, but not what everybody has done yet. So the next step would be completing a live emergency drill. And like I said, now that your tabletop is done, the next step is to actually run it, because what is said on paper and what is said in a classroom setting is not always going to be the same as when you have a live simulation of when you're running through the entire spill. Maybe someone forgets something, or maybe someone does something outside of what they said they would in the tabletop. So in the live emergency response drill, your first step is you're setting the stage. We're going to use the same scenario as before, that the truck backed into an oil tank and released 55 gallons. So you've set that stage. Your next step is inform parties of a possible drill. And the reason for informing them is you don't have to give them the exact date, but you do inform them that we're going to be running a drill. So this way, if you do call it in, they're not going to send the entire fire department or the entire response team to your facility and it's just a drill. Your third step is put the drill in motion, and then the final one is the taking notes portion, the reviewing of the notes. So let's set the stage. You've identified the setting. We now know that you have 55 gallons of material that is going to be spilled by a truck backing into an oil tank. You do want to use the same scenario as a tabletop, because you're linking the tabletop to the mock drill. Going with a different scenario, it could throw a spin on it, but that may result in doing a different tabletop with a different mock drill for that type of setting that you want to run. With using 55 gallons, you're not going to put 55 gallons of oil on the ground. You could look at, do you want the full effect? Should you put water on the ground and water left in the tank or drum? Or other means of doing this is if you were to use poly. So if you took a roll of poly sheeting and you laid poly out on the ground, when people come out, they have the visual, and you're saying that the poly sheeting is the contaminated area. With using poly sheeting, you can always roll it back up, and it's a reusable product that you could use for another instance farther down the road. And since your scenario involves a truck backing into the oil tank, will you have the truck in the area? The truck is going to be a big part of the spill, because how do you get the truck out of that area? Is the truck movable? Can it be deconned? Can you safely move the truck? That could play a huge part in this mock drill, where it may not have been fully identified in the tabletop. That could be, in most cases, you have 80% known, 20% unknown. This could be your 20% of unknown, and you don't know how people are going to act during the actual mock drill. So you've informed your parties of the drill. You don't necessarily need to give them the exact date and time. It's not needed of when you're specifically going to call them. It is a courtesy to let people know, because a heads up makes them aware of a potential call. Because what happens if they do have a real call that's been called in on that day that you want? Now that day, if they send everybody out to respond to another spill, how do you make sure that somebody is in the office to pick up that phone? Now there should always be someone there when you're calling in for a spill, whether it's a response line or somebody right in that facility, but they're at least aware that expect a phone call to come in. And then the type of drill is not needed, but sending the same scenario can help prepare them to come in for the mock drill. And then also identify what parties you'll call. You want to use the word may when you say who would be there. The fire department may be called, the DEP may be called, the police department may be on site, and the response company may be here to respond to the spill. So that'll leave a little question in their mind as to who are they going to be working with during this emergency response. So your next step is you put the drill in motion. You start internally with the live spill. So you do your live spill and it's called within the company. You're now putting your emergency action plan or your contingency plan to test internally. This is going to drive the external participation to this spill. So your internal emergency action plan and contingency plan are going to say who you call internally, and you're testing to make sure that they'll call the correct people internally if it goes to a security line or if it goes to on-site police department, or if it goes to your coordinator, do they let everybody else know that there's a spill and we need all hands on deck? And from there, you then assign someone. Let's say you're a one-person show and you're doing EHS and facilities. Is there someone you can rely on that can call for help? And also that person, can they take attendance as people show up and start the clock as to when they'll be there? And also, that same person could be your note taker to observe the emergency response and the public that could be involved. In this case, again, it could be you, but to better suit yourself through this mock drill, if you can get someone to take the notes that is familiar with your emergency action plan, your contingency plan, or the actions that would be taken by others, this will help you focus on the drill and run through the whole scenario, and then catch up with your person as to what they noticed, what you noticed, and compile all those notes together. Now, timing is everything when it comes to emergency response. The timing of when the spill is called in, when the response is put in motion, and when the response is fully completed and everything is cleaned up. You want to make sure you know how long for each responding party. By doing this mock drill, you're actually having people come to your site, and you can time it. If you look at your facility, almost all facilities will run fire drills. You run a fire drill, and you're looking to see how quickly you'll get out of a building. Well, this is similar to a fire drill, but it's running the drill with an emergency response. You have a release. So how quickly can you evacuate people internally? How quickly can you put your internal action plan in motion, and how quickly can your responders get to site? How long to evacuate the area? Now, when you're looking at evacuate the area, if you have a spill in a loading dock, but it's open to the air, are there any prevailing winds that you need to think about? Was that brought up in the tabletop? That may be something that wasn't thought of that you need to put in your notes to start looking at. So if you had a spill and the winds are blowing in right up against, let's say you're a higher education facility, the winds are blowing straight towards a dorm, do you either have all the windows closed or do you evacuate that dorm? Or if you're an industrial facility and the spill is outside and those winds are blowing down into a residential area, do you need to evacuate? And how long to protect the environment? So how long until your spill equipment is deployed? How long to clean up the area? And how long to remove the truck? The truck, like we said before, is a big part in this. Maybe the truck is blocking the area to do the spill cleanup. Now working with how you get the truck out of there could also mean you have to bring in one other party that wasn't part of the tabletop. Now you have the trucking company. How do you get the truck out of there? Does it need to be towed? Can it be driven away from the scene? That could be a huge part of your mock drill. And when going through and timing, you want to make sure that these good notes are taken of the time of call to the time of showing up to the time of taking action to the time of completion. You also want to take note of if the fire department shows up, how long until they're done. So if they're here just to block off the area, well, maybe they're done, but they're waiting for your response team to show up. Or if it is outside, will the police department at least leave one person there for the entire event? Will they be there to make sure no one walks through that area as it's being cleaned up? Because often, as people will walk by and they see a spill cleanup, they're going to ask a question. They want to know what's going on. So having that person to deflect will help in doing the mock drill. And what you could do in your mock drill is actually set someone up that they play that role. They walk in and they walk right into the area and start asking questions. How would the response company react to that? How would the police department react to that? How would the fire department react to that if they're all involved? How would your own people react to it if you had a passerby that just walked in? Now that could happen. Someone could walk right through the area not knowing that there's an actual response, and now they're tracking that material outside of the spill zone, outside of the hot zone. So these are things as you start to play through the actual mock drill that you can add in. So now that you've completed a mock drill, you've brought everybody in, you've shown them the scene, you've run through the whole entire cleanup, you've timed everybody, you've done the response, you've worked with the vehicle being in the area, how are you going to remove it? And if you wanted to, you put a person in there that was a passerby that walked right into the area. You've taken all these in notes, and now this becomes another training session. From the notes, you complete all notes of each person's tasks, and you invite all parties back to your facility. You want them back to review and to discuss what they did, what the other companies did, and what your company did. So you want to review them all together. So it's all out in the open, and people can help each other to develop a better way to do a response. Review observations of each individual group. Make sure you show your internal group's actions through this. If there's something that you can improve on your side, identify it. If there's something you see that could be improved on an external party's side, you want to identify that and see if any of the other groups can help in that response. So if the fire department can't do the actual cleanup, but they're the first ones on hand, is there a different... Do they have any training where they could just put down pig socks, or they could put down speedy dry? or make changes to your program, both in your program and in theirs. So if they have a specific response program for your facility, well, that may need to be updated. Or you could also adopt that into your response plan. So when it gets down to in the event of a spill, fire department will show up and they'll do X. The response company will show up and they'll do X, Y, and Z, and the police department will take care of Y. And from there, we've talked about training a lot throughout all three sessions, is you want to retrain as needed. You know, is retraining needed? If you make a change to your emergency action plan or to your contingency plan and you change the methods as to how you're going to do the cleanup, well, then you should retrain everybody. If there's a large change in your response company as to what they do for you, then there should be a training on their end. If the fire department comes out and they're doing something that they shouldn't on your facility, or they need extra material to come out, then that's a type of retraining. But this could either be a group retraining on your contingency plan, your emergency action plan, or the steps taken to clean up the spill. It may also just be a training on your side to train your coordinators, train your emergency response team as to what to expect in the event of a spill. So again, back to the key message is drills are planned, they're implemented, and they're reviewed as a training means of educating everyone involved on the appropriate response in the event of a true emergency response. Like I said before, training was mentioned multiple times, and this is a training exercise. Running a tabletop drill and running a mock drill is really a type of training. It's a structured training that has open-ended questions and answers that are part of it. It needs to be interactive. If it's one-sided of doing a mock drill or a tabletop, then it's really not helping your company, the fire department, police department, or your response company. It needs to be looked at as a full-scale, multiple department training on how to better serve your company and how to better serve protecting the environment at your facility. So in summary, for completing a tabletop or a mock drill, you want to identify those who should be involved. This is the key to being an effective drill and an effective training scenario. You want to identify the scenario that you're going to be dealing with. Is it going to be your worst case scenario, or is it going to be your best case scenario? And what level do you want to test? Maybe you want to go somewhere in between. Maybe you want to test how you can make a worst case into a best case, or you could train on best case and throw a curveball in there that now makes it worst case. Identifying that on your end helps set the stage. You complete the tabletop drill. It's a classroom setting drill. It's a sit down. Everybody's in a room. It's all on paper. It's all thoughts, and it's really a brainstorming activity on how do we respond to this type of spill that can come in. Then you go into completing a live emergency drill. You put the tabletop into action. You take everything that was brought up in the tabletop discussion, and you incorporate it into doing this live drill. Maybe somebody asked about the public being in there. Maybe someone asked if someone went down during the spill, or maybe someone asked if the truck that hit the oil tank took off. And now you have worst case because you may have an oil trail with the tire tracks. You then go into the review of the drill. Now you're going to do a review after the tabletop with everybody. And then you're also going to do a review of the live emergency mock drill with everybody. So you really have two different steps of review. You have a completed tabletop drill, then you have a review of the tabletop and questions, then you complete the live emergency mock drill, and then you review the live emergency mock drill. And the last part of this whole process is you make improvements and updates. And the key word is improvement. Part of doing tabletop and a mock drill is really to peel the onion back and see how you can improve your process and how you can improve the process of others that are going to help you in this time of need. And once you make the improvements and the updates, you then want to retrain as needed. You know, if the update is just changing a phone number, maybe that's not a full retraining. Maybe that's just want to identify this one page of the emergency action plan, you send it out to everybody and it's highlighted. But if there's a major change to an emergency action plan or a contingency plan or the response actions from the outside vendors, it could be a larger training. Could be an hour training, could be a full day training. It all depends on how big of the improvement or the update it is to your response. And you get those really from doing the tabletop and the mock drill. This is a form of training that could also result in retraining to make your response and the response time of others better for your facility. So at this point, I know there's a lot of information that was put into doing these type of tabletops, doing the tabletop and the mock drill. I would like to open up for any questions. We do have a good amount of time for questions from people. But if you do have any, feel free to ask.
Thanks, Kevin. We've got a few questions that have come in already. And I know there's probably several more out there. So as Kevin said, we will open the floor now to questions. We've got about 20 minutes, and we'll get to as many as we can. Otherwise, feel free to follow up with us afterwards, but we'll take advantage of this time. Kevin, the first question that came in asks, what if someone on the emergency action plan or the contingency plan doesn't want to participate in this process or in this drill? What would you do?
In that case, you may either, one, look to replace that name on the emergency action plan or contingency plan. That would be a little hard if it's the police department and they can't partake in your drill. If it's the fire department, you know, in some towns it's a volunteer fire department. That's a little tough to get them in there. But you want to try your hardest to get them in that area or into the drill, because if you explain to them that it's going to help when they respond, you may get a little bit more out of them to show up. But there have been a lot of cases where maybe the hospital doesn't show up, or the police department doesn't show up, or the fire department doesn't show up. The number one that you should really get out there is definitely your emergency response company. To go through that tabletop with them, because they're the ones that you're going to rely on to do the cleanup. But it has happened in the past that, you know, the fire department didn't have the staff to be out there, or the police department didn't have the staff, or the hospital just didn't want to come out to the scene because they're going to get everything on the back end when they're brought to the hospital.
Right. So you really want to clarify the benefit of having each party present. And the impact it can have if they're not. So that, I think that's really helpful. The next question is a good one. We have a few that about timing. And this one asks, this is from Erica, how long do you typically wait between running the tabletop drill and then executing the live drill?
If it only takes you a day or two to compile all the notes and make any necessary changes, or maybe you don't have any changes, you could run that drill within a week. You could run it within a couple days, but if there's a lot of changes and there's a lot more follow-up, it could take a little bit longer. You do want to make sure that it's fresh in people's mind to come through and do the mock drill, but you could also go the other side of it, where it's fresh in people's mind from doing the tabletop, and you wait that extra week to really test people to make sure they remember it when they come in for the mock drill. So I wouldn't let it go more than a month, but I would definitely try and do it within, you know, a week to 3 weeks from doing the tabletop.
That's a good window. I hope that answers Erica's question. And following up on that, we went through the live drill, and you mentioned the importance of making improvements and updates after the review. So would you advise actually doing a follow-up drill once those changes have been made?
I would, if it's major changes.
Okay.
So let's say you had somebody, the response didn't go accurately. It actually went past the loading dock area. You can envision it getting into a storm drain, and it went farther down because the response wasn't quick enough or not enough information was passed over. If there's a lot of issues that came up with it, I would do a retraining for everybody and then run another mock drill after that to test out the retraining that you gave to everyone.
Great. And can you sort of give us an example of what something that you've seen changed as a result of a live drill?
Yep. One thing that has changed is the addition of making sure that there was either a police detail or some type of security detail at a mock drill. And the reason for that is going through one mock drill scenario, someone actually did put one person was a key part of this being a passerby. And that person walked in, came up for the mock drill, and walked right underneath the caution tape because their sidewalk was on one side of the spill, and the building that they needed to get into was on the other side of the spill. So they walked right through it and went into their building. Now, that turns your worst case even into a larger worst case scenario because you now have a contaminated person, and you also have contamination on the walkway, and how far into the building did they get? So with that particular facility, they didn't have the police or their own security at the mock drill. So the next one, they requested them, and they put in the issue that showed up by not having them there. And the next time they did that tabletop mock drill, they had the police department there. So it turned into a requirement that you had to be there.
Great. And we know the importance of having each of those pieces and parties present. So you laid out the scenario of the oil tank spill. Is that based on a real-world situation? And if not, do you have an example of one that was a response that was improved or went over fairly well because of the presence of mock drills and, you know, good preparedness?
So the scenario is based off of actually five spills that Triumvirate has worked on in the last 9 months, where this has happened in regards to the storage of grease at facilities. And the changes that I've made to that is you do have trucks that come in and out of loading docks. A lot of times you'll find grease or you'll find oil drums or waste drums of grease or oil that are stored outside or they're in a grease collection or an oil collection area. In these cases, in all five of them, they didn't have any concrete barriers or any concrete bollards that would protect those drums. So the scenario that they looked at and what could have been prevented by doing a tabletop or a mock drill is identify the place where you're having drum storage isn't well protected from being hit by a vehicle. So by choosing this scenario, it does become, these were true life scenarios that happened in emergencies where you did have a truck involved. And these also went over the threshold where now you have the DEP involved, because state to state will differ as to when you have to call the DEP if it is a release to the environment. And from there, it threw a complete change to the emergency response because the DEP took over the entire response and listed out what needed to be done, what steps they wanted, and how long the response would take. It also included putting oil boom down in catch basins. So doing this type of mock drill and putting into the play the reportable quantity that could happen or any type of spill response notification to the DEP, it throws a huge, huge wrench into it, but if there was training up front, those could have been prevented.
Great. That's good advice, Kevin. Thank you. You know, another question, I think I know the answer to this one, asks, what if I hadn't had a spill, or we've never had a spill? Do I need to practice, and how often would you recommend practicing if the risk is really low?
By saying not training or not running a drill isn't the best answer. If you've never had a spill, it's either it's by luck or you know you've trained somewhere or you've given people training on your hazmat or contingency plan in the past, but you've never run a drill. What happens in the event, because it is an emergency, you never know when they're going to happen. If you've never trained on it and the spill happens, how do you ensure that the people on your facility know what to do? So I would suggest, if you've never done one, to at least do one tabletop and run through to see if there are any gaps. If it is a low risk facility, maybe you do it every other year. You could do it annually. You could do it as part of a refresher that you do with people. And 1 year you do the tabletop, and the other year you do the tabletop and the mock drill if you are low risk. But I would suggest going through this training exercise, because in emergencies, you never know when they're going to happen. And the best way to make a worst case emergency into best case is training.
Great. And I have a good follow-up to that from an attendee here that asks, you know, going along with training, can this actually count a mock drill towards our 8-hour annual refresher training requirement?
And there are some other aspects that go into that to meet the OSHA guidelines for the refresher. There, you could certainly take part of the drill and put it into your refresher. You're actually doing the full, you're running through the HAZWOPA response. But there is some classroom time that you want to cover, because part of HAZWOPA may not fully cover the spill you went through. So I would say part of it, yes, you could put it into there, but I wouldn't use a mock drill as a way to replace your HAZWOPA. It could be an added value to your HAZWOPA refresher.
Okay, that makes sense. Great. That should answer that question. So with a few minutes left, I think we'll take two more questions. Kevin, thanks for all the responses, and I want to thank everyone who attended for asking these questions and for your attention. And there's a lot of timing questions. I know this is one that we kind of discussed, but someone wants to know, would you recommend a certain time of day? I mean, we talked about the pros and cons, doing this in the morning, you know, doing it at the end of the day. If you're doing a live drill, kind of a surprise, what would you recommend?
Well, when you look at emergency response or emergencies that happen, they hardly ever happen during the day. Emergencies usually happen first thing in the morning. They're happening at the end of the day when people are trying to get out. They're usually going to happen on a Friday. People want to get out and start the weekend, or they may happen on a weekend. But in the event of a mock drill, do you want to run something on a Friday where you bring everybody in? That would be a upfront conversation you'd want to have with each parties to say, we want to run a full drill. Would you be willing to run the drill on a Friday afternoon? Now that's working with your responders and working with the fire department to let them know that we're gonna do this as if it was a true response. But you could also run it during the day. If you do run it during normal business hours, you're then going to add in a different aspect to the spill. You're going to have a lot more people involved and a lot more passing by that could be part of the spill. Maybe they don't know that the actual mock drill is going on, and they come up and ask questions that you weren't prepared for that person to come over and be part of it. So there's pros and cons to run on each side. It could definitely work by running it during the day. If you want to do a quick type of mock drill on a Friday afternoon where you meet internally and then you just make phone calls to people and let them know you have this scenario, what would you do? We've had that happen where a few companies have called us on Friday at 5 o'clock in the afternoon and say, we have a spill, what could you do? After they go through it, then they've said, thank you, this was a test, and it was a part of our mock drill. So there are pros to doing both.
Got it. Thanks. So we'll do one final question. This one kind of gets back to our poll question, so we'll kind of tie this together. We learned that about 50% of attendees are doing these annually, the mock drills, which to me it sounds pretty good. I mean, is that what you recommend, Kevin? And if not, what would you recommend as far as frequency?
I would at least do them annually. If you're a large facility that you've identified where you have four areas that are high risk, are you going to do one of those high risk areas each year? In those cases, it would be case by case based on the facility. If you have some scenarios, you know, two or three, that could be worst case, then maybe you run two tabletops and two mock drills, or you do it three times a year. It's really going to be based on the facility, the size of the facility, what you have as a potential release, and then what you want to run. You know, if you ran one and you see that some issues came up that could really affect another, what you thought was best case is now worst case, you just went from having it once a year to twice. But I would, as a rule of thumb, at least do it annually at every facility.
Great. Well, thank you, Kevin. I think we'll wrap it up there. Some great questions that have come in. I think we did our best to get to just about all of them. And if anyone has any follow-up to this discussion, feel free to reach out to us. I know within the next day or two, we're going to be reaching out to you with these materials. So again, we did get a question or two about those materials. You will get the recording and the slide deck, if not today, at least by tomorrow. And we'll also have a special offer for you related to mock drill planning and execution to help you get better prepared in the event of emergency. So Kevin, do you have anything else to add before we close down for the day?
Just that, you know, doing the tabletop and the actual mock drill can sometimes seem it might be burdensome to the other companies that you have involved. And I wouldn't look at it as that way. It's a huge part of helping your company and also helping them understand your company. So doing these and, you know, showing that you want to help them support you goes a long way when it comes to an emergency response. So if you don't have them in place, I would definitely suggest putting mock drills in place. And those of you that are currently doing that, I think that's great in your facility. I would say to keep it up.
Great advice. All right. Well, thanks, Kevin. That pretty much closes our ER series, but we've got more webinars in the pipeline, so feel free to check back in, and we hope to see you sometime soon. Have a great day, everyone.